We're going to begin our discussion of regional skeletal muscle. We're going to start superiorly and work our way inferiorly, but we're going to start with the head. And we actually have quite a few unique divisions in terms of skeletal muscle within the head. And we're going to start with one that we're probably most familiar with, which are muscles of facial expression. Now, what's unique about muscles of facial expression is that they're located within subcutaneous tissue, so they're located within the fat, and very importantly, they're going to be attached to bone, fascia, but their distal attachments are always going to be on the skin. So when the muscles contract, they're going to pull the skin and allow us to express emotion. So it allows us to smile, frown, tense up, etc. So all these expressions are these muscles right here. Now, embryologically, they're all developing from the same sheet, and when you have similar embryological development, that indicates that you have similar innervation, and that's true here. All muscles of facial expression are going to be innervated by the facial nerve or cranial nerve 7. So this is one of those cases where anatomy really makes sense. Facial nerve is going to innervate facial muscles. And you can see in this dissection here, this cadaveric dissection, you have your parotid gland right here next to your ear. And then you see all of these branches, all of these efferent branches. These are branches of the facial nerve heading to those muscles of facial expression. So let's look at a clinical connection in terms of the facial nerve. So very closely associated with the parotid gland, and also importantly, we're very closely associated with the ear. So if you have some type of inflammation, if you have an ear infection, etc., that can cause inflammation there and cause pinching on the facial nerve. If you have that, you can have what's referred to as facial nerve palsy, and a lot of times you hear this disorder referred to as Bell's palsy. And what will happen is you have a unilateral, or on one side, drooping of the facial muscles. So you can't contract, you can't get those muscles to have emotion in terms of that. So you can see that in this visual here. You can have the inability to wrinkle your brow, drooping eyelids, and importantly, drooping corner of the mouth. So food, fluids, etc., can really just kind of accumulate within that oral vestibule. Now, it is very closely in terms of presentation to a stroke. The big difference in terms of a stroke is typically when a stroke presents, it's only going to be in the lower portion of the face. Whereas with Bell's palsy or facial nerve palsy, it'll be the entirety of the face, so including the brow. So if you can wrinkle your brow, that typically means that that could be an indication of stroke, whereas if everything on one side is not contracting, typically Bell's palsy. All right. So let's talk about a few of the more important muscles of facial expression, and we'll start with the one that surrounds your eye, which is your orbicularis oculi. So oculi is going to be similar to oculus, so anytime you have anything with that term, you know it has to do with the eye. And this is a sphincteric muscle, meaning that it's going to allow for closing to occur. So not only closing your eyelids, but also wrinkling your forehead. So it allows for the closing, not the opening of the eye. The buccinator, sometimes you hear this referred to as the buccinator, same thing. This is a unique muscle, still considered a muscle of facial expression, but what you can notice in this visual right here, it's actually fairly deep in comparison to the rest of the muscles of facial expression. Now this muscle is particularly important when you're blowing, when you spread your cheeks out like this, your buccinator is really activating then. It can allow for this to occur. So if you think in terms of using a trumpet, those individuals have very well-developed buccinator muscles. The last muscle of facial expression that I want you to know is your orbicularis oris. And the reason that it's important, it's really your first sphincter associated with your gastrointestinal system. So this is what's allowing for you to close your oral fissure or your lips in order to allow food to head back towards the pharynx and eventually get to the rest of the GI system. So not only does it close the oral fissure, but it plays a role in terms of compressing and protruding your lips. So it can play a role in terms of puckering your lips like this. And you can really kind of feel those muscles right there. Okay, So those muscles of facial expression, those are very close to the surface, attached to the skin. We're going to move a little bit deeper in terms of muscles that are going to move the eyeball. And we're going to specifically talk about what we refer to as extraocular eye muscles. Now, most of these muscles are going to be innervated by your oculomotor nerve, which is your cranial nerve 3. You have two muscles that are exceptions. You have your lateral rectus, which is going to be innervated by your abducens nerve or cranial nerve 6, and your superior oblique, which you only can see the tendon right here in this visual, but that's going to be innervated by your trochlear nerve or cranial nerve 4. Now, there's four main actions that can occur at the eyeball, and I want you to do this with me as we discuss it. You can elevate or look up, look down, depress. Now, look to the side, kind of pull your finger, look this way. You're abducting your eye, okay? Or pull it back towards your nose and look at your finger. That's adduction. Okay, so those are the four main movements that can occur at the eyeball, and they're caused by this complex of muscles right here. Now, one thing that you can't see in this visual in terms of the dissection is during life, all this area is filled in by fat. There is a great deal of fat within the orbit that's really protecting not only the globe of the eye, but these muscles. And one other thing I want you to note, we'll talk more about this when we talk about the endocrine system, is your lacrimal gland, or the gland that produces tears, is very closely associated. Okay, the big muscles when we're talking about the head, the muscles of mastication. There are four muscles of mastication. They're all going to affect your TMJ joint or your temporomandibular joint, so allowing for you to open and close your mouth, protrude, and retrude your chin. And all of these muscles are going to be innervated by the only efferent branch of your trigeminal nerve or your third division, mandibular division. So let's talk about each one of these because these are particularly important and these are really ones that you can palpate or feel. So let's start with your temporalis muscle. So let's start, and this is really where these bony attachments are going to start coming in that we've been discussing. So we talked previously about your superior and inferior temporal lines, and I want you to kind of get an idea of where that's going to be. So if you kind of clench your jaw, you can feel your temporalis muscle contract. So you're going to start at your temporal lines and move down to the coronoid process, which remember is anterior to the mandibular condyle. So you can really clench and feel your temporalis muscle. This is the second most powerful of your muscles. Powerful muscle in terms of muscles of mastication, and it plays a big role in terms of powerful elevation or closing of the mandible, okay? So if you think about gravity allowing for your mouth to open and really powerfully closing, you can feel that temporalis muscle working. It does play a role in terms of retracting or bringing the chin back into anatomical position as well. Now, the strongest muscle, so the most powerful muscle of mastication, is your masseter or your masseter muscle. You'll hear it either way. And this really, similar to the temporalis, and most muscles of mastication play a big role in terms of closing the mandible or elevating the mandible. It's also one of the main protruders or allowing you to jut out your chin. And you can see right here in this visual, your masseter muscle. So those facial nerve branches are going to be superficial and your masseter is right underneath it. And you can palpate this one as well, particularly when you clench right on the side. If you can feel the angle of your mandible, you can feel your masseter right there. Okay, so you have two other muscles. They both have a pterygoid within their name. You have lateral pterygoid, and this one is one of the more unique ones. First of all, there's two different heads of your lateral pterygoid muscle. You have a superior head, which you can see here, and an inferior head right here. And this particular muscle is actually going to attach on the capsule of your TMJ. So it is very directly associated with the TMJ capsule. Now, what's unique about this muscle in comparison to the rest of the muscles of mastication is that it is the only one that really plays a role in terms of depression or opening of your mouth, okay? So when you think of really powerful opening, like what I'm doing right there, that's going to be this lateral pterygoid contracting. The main force in terms of opening the mouth is typically gravity, but in the more powerful actions, you're going to be using your lateral pterygoid muscles. And lastly, you have your medial pterygoid. This is a mirror image, basically, of your masseter. Whereas the masseter was going to be on this side of the ramus of the mandible, so that's the one that when you contract, you can feel. On the opposite side of the ramus of the mandible, which would have been right here, it's been removed in this visual, that's where you're going to have your medial pterygoid. You can see it a little bit right there. So similar to the other muscles of mastication, other than lateral pterygoid, plays a big role in terms of elevation of the mandible. Okay, now we're going even deeper. So in this particular visual, if you haven't seen a visual like this, let's get used to it. This is a hemisected head, meaning that there has been a cut right down the sagittal plane, and we're looking inside. So I were to cut right here, we're looking at this portion of the head. This is the only way that you can really see the muscles of the soft palate. So everybody put your tongue on the top of your mouth. You're feeling your hard palate. If you were to move more posteriorly, then you're moving into the soft palate, which is right here. So here's hard palate. This is what you feel with your tongue. And if you continued posteriorly, that is the soft palate. And it's actually composed of 5 muscles, so considerably smaller than what we had in terms of muscles of mastication and even muscles of facial expression. And the main role of these muscles are to elevate and depress your soft palate, as well as to kind of tense up the soft palate. So it plays a big role in terms of the pharynx and allowing food, and only so much food, to actually go into the pharynx. All of these muscles are going to be innervated by your vagus nerve, and that makes sense. This is component of the GI. GI, you think vagus. There is one particular muscle, the tensor veli palatini, that has its independent innervation, which is mandibular division of trigeminal. So if we were to dissect, there's mucosa surrounding these muscles right here. And if you were to dissect that region, you would have 5 individual muscles. And you can see some are actually kind of attaching this way. All right, last but not least, in terms of muscles of the head, we can't not talk about the muscles of the tongue. And actually, the tongue is just a mass of muscles. You do have mucosa covering it, but you can see this entire region right here in this hemisected dissection. This is all tongue, okay? All tongue right here. And you have 2 main types of muscles associated with the tongue. You have extrinsic muscles. And in this particular case, extrinsic muscles are going to originate outside of the tongue and attach within the tongue. And these particularly will play a role in terms of altering the position of the tongue. So moving your tongue to the left or the right, these are extrinsic muscles. And then additionally, if you can see right here, all these fibers, including up in this region, these are intrinsic muscles of the tongue. These are going to originate and insert all within the tongue mass. And this is really what's going to allow for you to change the shape of your tongue and allow for the finer tuned portions of speaking. So if you can roll your tongue, that's your intrinsic muscles are playing a role there. All these muscles are going to be innervated by your 12th cranial nerve or your hypoglossal nerve. So that's pretty much the main purpose of this efferent nerve is innervating this large mass of muscles. So that is a quick description of the main muscles of the head. We're going to continue our discussion with the muscles of the neck.